When it comes to the topic of our children, the Holy Quran, the Book of God, the Book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, clearly illustrates two points. The first point is that our children are the greatest, or one of the greatest blessings that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives us. And they are a source of our pride. The Holy Quran says, المال والبنون زينة الحياة الدنيا. Allah says that wealth and children are the adornment. They beautify this world, this life for us. And that's why we love our children so much. And thus it's stated that during the Jahiliyyah, the Arabs used to take so much pride in their children. A father would walk and five sons on his right, five sons on his left. And they used to boast about their children. The more children I have, the more exalted I am. And that's why when they used to fight Rasulullah, some of the enemies of our Prophet, what would they tell him? They used to tell him, we are better than you. And what was their reasoning? They used to tell him, we're better than you because we have more wealth and more children than you. وَقَالُوا نَحْنُ أَكْثَرُ أَمْوَالًا وَأَوْلَادًا. We have more children than you, and that's why we're better. So they used to show off their children. They used to boast about their children. Some people, they show off their wealth. Others, they show off their children. And when it comes to Islam, you find Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam, he's narrated in one hadith, he says, تَنَاكَحُوا تَنَاسَلُوا فَإِنِّي أُبَاهِي بِكُمُ الْأُمَمِ يَوْمَ الْقِيَامَةِ. He says, get married and have lots of children, because on the Day of Judgment, I, Rasulullah, will boast about you Muslims. Because we Muslims are like the children of Rasulullah, we're his followers. And the more we are, the more proud Rasulullah will be on the Day of Judgment. And that's why certain narrations tell us that Imam Ali ibn Abi Talib alayhi salam had as many as 28 children. Imam al-Kadhim alayhi salam, our seventh Imam, had as many as 37 children. So our children are the source of our pride. And they are a blessing from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But as they say, there is no blessing that comes without any strings attached. Because the Holy Quran, at the same time that it says that one of the greatest blessings is your children, the Holy Quran also says in one verse, the second verse, the Holy Quran says, إِنَّمَا أَمْوَالُكُمْ وَأَوْلَادُكُمْ فِتْنَةً. The Holy Quran says that your children are what? Fitna. Allah will test you with your children. So at the same time that my child is a blessing, but if this child is not taken care of and brought up in the right way, that blessing can turn into my worst nightmare. That blessing can turn into a curse. How many mothers and fathers do I know and you know that they struggle with their children? They have so many problems with their children. How many fathers and mothers, they have sleepless nights because of their children, because of the problems of their children, and especially in the teenage years. Because it's difficult, brothers and sisters, raising a child to be behaving, to be good, practicing, faithful individual is not an easy task. It's very, very difficult. And that's why the Quran calls our children fitna. We're going to be tested with our children. Allah gives me this child, and this child is a responsibility. Can I handle this responsibility or not? But what we notice is many people, many parents, many fathers and mothers, they take good care of their children's physical needs. They give them the best health, the best education, the best food and shelter. But when it comes to the spiritual needs of their children, they're indifferent. They don't really care. Some parents worry more about their child's cavity than their children's iman, faith, salah, hijab, sawm. So the question is here, as a father or mother, many of you here are parents, or inshallah one day you'll get married and you will have the honor of being parents. The question is here, why is it necessary that I bring my child up with faith? Why is it important? Why, as a father or mother, should I worry that my child grows up to be a practicing Muslim, to be a devout, God-fearing Muslim? Why is that important? Why should that be in my agenda when I want to bring up my child? You see, besides the obvious fact that I mentioned, that our children have both physical and spiritual needs, and as a loving and caring father and mother, I should cater to both. Not just the physical, the spiritual needs. And faith is one of the needs of the child. Despite this fact, if I raise my child in an Islamic way, in a way in which I cater for his spiritual needs as well, this will work in my interest as well, the father and mother. I will benefit from this as well. How so? Two ways. If I raise my child in an Islamic way, me, the father and the mother, I will benefit in two ways. How? Number one, you find many parents, when their children are growing up, and especially when they reach the age of what? The teenage years. They have many concerns, many things that they worry about. And there are two main things that they worry about. The first thing is that they fear rebellion from their children. I, the father and the mother, raised this child. I spent money on this child. I love this child. I sacrifice for this child. Once he becomes a teenager, he rebels. He no longer listens to me. He begins to disrespect me. One of the greatest fears of parents is what? Is having an ungrateful father, an ungrateful son or daughter. But if I raise my child in the Islamic way, I will never have to fear that. Do you know why? Because I tell you, there is no religion in the world today that stresses on the importance of the respect of parents like Islam. Search amongst all the religions. You will never find a religion that stresses the importance of respecting parents like Islam to the extent that I mentioned the verse a few days ago. The Holy Quran says, فَلَا تَقُلْ لَهُمَا أُفٍّ. Do not even tell them uff. Uff is the smallest and least expression of dissatisfaction. It's the smallest thing. It's the smallest way in which you what? You express your dissatisfaction. The Holy Quran says, if your mother, your father tell you to do something, you say, uff. You don't want to do it. The Quran says this is a sin. Don't say that. In another verse, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَقَضَى رَبُّكَ أَلَّا تَعْبُدُوا إِلَّا إِيَّاهُ وَبِالْوَالِدَيْنِ إِحْسَانًا. He says, Allah has mandated that you human beings worship God. That's number one. What's number two after worshiping God? وَبِالْوَالِدَيْنِ إِحْسَانًا. Number two, right after worshiping God, is respecting your parents. This is the second most important thing. So that's why if I raise my child in a way in which he reads the Quran and he listens to the Quran, listens to the words of God, this will work for my benefit, because Allah is telling the children, respect your parents. I will never fear rebellion. So that's number one. That's the first fear. The second fear that many parents have is what? They fear that when their children enter the teenage years, they're going to enter into crimes, drugs, and many other immoral acts. And likewise, if I raise my child in an Islamic way, I never have to fear those things. Why? Because if I plant in my child the fear of God, the fear of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, I will be sure that my child will never ever go towards immorality. I know my child will never go towards crime, towards drugs. Why? Not because I have to tell him. Because once I plant within my child the fear of God, that fear will be the deterrent. Because he fears Allah, he will never go to drugs. Because that child fears Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he'll never go into crimes. So do you see how beautiful? Just plant the fear of God in your children, the love of God in your children, build a connection between your child and God, and you never have to worry again. Allah will take care of everything. God will what? Will guide them to respecting me, and God will guide them to stay away from all of that immorality. So it works in my best interest if I raise my child in an Islamic way. So this is number one. This is the first way that I, as a father or mother, benefit from my child's faith. The second way that I, as a father or mother, benefit from my child's faith is that our children are one of the best investments that we can have. You see, we all look for investments. We want to invest in this life so that we can benefit in the long run. Many of us invest in the stock market. Others, we invest in real estate. Others, in merchandise, and so many other things. But what you find is, when I invest in my child, and when I bring up my child in a way in which he is always reciting Quran, in a way in which he fears Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, not only will I benefit from my child in this life, but I'll also benefit after I die. You see, all these investments, as soon as I die, they're no use. That's it. If you own thousands of acres and you're making rent from all of those, or you have so much stocks and you're making money out of those, as soon as you die, you're never going to benefit anymore from those. But my child, if I raise a God-fearing, good practicing, faithful religious child, I will benefit from that child even after my death. First of all, how do I benefit from my child in this world? Besides the first point that we mentioned, any good deed that my child does, my dear brothers and sisters, Allah will also reward me. Because the hadith says, "الدال على الخير كفاعله." You've all heard this hadith. The hadith says if you guide someone to doing something good, if I tell my brother, do something good, and he goes and he does something good because I guided him and taught him that, Allah says that I will reward you as well because you are the one that taught that person and guided that person to that good. Correct? Imagine if that child, all that he contains, which is good, it was from the mother and father. Every good deed that child will do, Allah will reward me because I'm responsible for it. And even after I die, I'm in my grave, I'm dead, khalas, I can no longer do any good deeds. I see I'm getting reward after reward after reward. I ask the angels why. They tell me because your son and your daughter are doing good deeds and you're benefiting from them. And not only will they do good deeds, but they'll do good deeds for me. You see, the Quran teaches us if I want to be a grateful son and daughter, what do I have to do? I have to always do dua, prayer for my father and mother. Always pray for your parents, whether they are alive or dead, and especially if they're dead. Every single day, brothers and sisters, the Quran says pray for your parents. The Holy Quran says, وَخْفِضْ لَهُمَا جَنَاحَ الذُّلِّ مِنَ الرَّحْمَةِ وَقُلْ رَبِّ ارْحَمْهُمَا كَمَا رَبَّيَانِ صَغِيرًا. Every day, brothers and sisters, do a dua for your parents. Tell God, Ya Allah, I ask you to bless my parents. I ask you to show my parents mercy in the same way they were merciful with me when I was a child. So I'm in my grave, I'm dead, but my child is what? My son and my daughter are doing good deeds for me. They read Quran for me. They read dua for me. They donate for an Islamic or a good cause for me. And I am the one that's receiving all what? All the ajr. Do you see what a beautiful investment? Plant in your children the love of God. Allah will do all the rest for you. So these are two ways we benefit from our children. But you find Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He tells us that a believer, he does a dua. Every believer should do a dua regarding their children. The Holy Quran says in the verse I began my lecture with, Allah says, وَالَّذِينَ يَقُولُونَ رَبَّنَا هَبْ لَنَا مِنْ أَزْوَاجِنَا وَذُرِّيَّاتِنَا قُرَّةَ أَعْيُنَ. Every believer makes this dua. What is this dua? He asks Allah, Ya Allah, I want you to give me from my children and my offsprings the comfort of my heart and the joy of my eyes. Every day I should ask Allah to give me children that will give me comfort. Do you know how many parents suffer from their children? Because of their children, they suffer. I have to ask Allah to give me children that will give me comfort. Not that lead me to suffering because of their problems. Every day I get a phone call from school. Look what your son, look what your daughter did. Sometimes I get a phone call from the police station. Look what we caught your son or daughter doing. Is this a life that we look forward to? I want comfort for my children. The joy of my eyes for my children. I do this dua every day. And this comfort and this joy, my friends, does not come for free. It's not just going to happen automatically one day. It's not going to be planted in my children when they are in school. If I want comfort for my children, don't think that the public schools will teach my children to be in that way. Don't think that the TV will teach my child to be in a way in which I will be comfortable. The TV nor the public schools will teach our children respect your parents. Never. I went to public schools. I watched the TV. Never ever in my life I hear your teacher respect your parents. Even if there is, it's very rare. This only comes from what? From my hard work, brothers and sisters. My effort. The more time I spend on my children, the more effort I put into them, the greater the result. Just like business. If you have a business, the more time you spend on your business, the greater the profit. The same exact thing applies with our children. That's why we have to spend time with our children, my friends. We should not neglect them. Do you know now in America, in the U.S., has the highest rate of prisoners in the world? And just yesterday or 2 days ago, I was reading something in the news that so many senators and congressmen, they want to find a solution to this huge population of inmates in America. What do we do with all these inmates? Not only is it, bad for us, but it's also costing us because all of, all these inmates are being spent on from our taxes. So what do we do? Do you know what's the leading cause to crime in America? Why do people commit crimes? The leading cause to crime and substance abuse, drugs, is what? Studies say the leading cause to crime and substance abuse is the absence of the father in the family. When there is no guiding father in the family, the human being collapses. They did a study on those inmates. Do you know what most of them had in common? Their father was absent when they were young, either because he was dead, or because he was in the prisons, or because he just abandoned the family and went and found another life. To an extent that I read in one statistic that in some of the states in the U.S., 90% of, up to 90% of the juvenile detention centers, which are all what? All youth, all young guys that have what, committed crimes. Up to 90% of the inmates of those juvenile detention centers had one thing in common. What was it? They were raised without a father present. The father wasn't there. 90% of them had no father. The father was dead or was absent from their lives for whatever reason. And another statistic I read that said that the rate of teenage pregnancy, you know, now if you hear a girl that's 12 years old that gets pregnant, it's normal. It happens so often. A 12, 13, 14-year-old girl that gets pregnant, it's normal in these days because the parents are absent from the lives of these children. Do you know that I read a statistic that said the rate of teenage girls getting pregnant is up to 8 times higher amongst those girls whose fathers were absent in their early years? Do some research. Just Google it, you'll find these stats. Up to 8 times higher. Do you see how vital, how important the role of the father is? And not just the father, the mother, but especially the father. And that's why this all shows us that we have to spend time with our children. We have to get involved. Do you think these inmates, they had the honor and privilege of a father over them, telling them what to do, guiding them? They didn't. Since their parents didn't raise them, the streets raised them, the public schools, TV raised them, and that's what you get, all these inmates. 90% had no fathers. We have to, brothers and sisters, we have to pay attention to all of this. And you find statistics say that an average, do you know an average mother in the U.S., how many hours does she spend with her child? An average mother, not the small children, but school children mostly, and especially teenagers. An average mother in the U.S. spends 13 hours a week only. Only 13 hours a week. As for the father, it's even worse. The average father spends only 7 hours with his child a week. So 1 hour a day, 23 hours, he's with his friends and school and TV and sleeping and eating, and only 1 hour with the father. But how many hours do we spend on our work? Statistics state 45 hours the American spends on work. 45 hours a week on work, but 7 hours with his child. And then when we see our children going into crimes and substance, we say, why? Do you know why? Because while I was building my financial empire, my child was let loose in the streets. I know many parents, brothers and sisters, mashallah, wealthy. Allah has given them so much wealth. But what you find is they have so many problems with their children. They have the worst children. Their sons, they grow up, he's in the 20s. Every day there's a problem. Either it's a financial problem, or it's a moral problem, or he breaks a law. Every single day it's a headache. But mashallah, he's a millionaire. Is he benefiting from his wealth? Do you know why that happened? Because while he was busy building and accumulating all that wealth, his child was being raised by others, by the streets, by the TV. And then we ask why. And then once we run into problems, we come to the scholars. Why? Mawlana, Sheikh, Sayyid, look at my son. Where were you? For 15, 20 years, you were asleep in business, and now you come to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, now that you need him. So that's why, brothers and sisters, it's essential and vital that we spend time with our children. 1 hour a day, brothers and sisters, is too little. I have to spend much more time with my child, much more time with my son and my daughter. And that's why tonight, for the remaining of the minutes, I will mention three important steps, three practical important steps that we have, that we can apply in our lives with our relationships with our children in order to secure that we have children that give us what? The comfort of our heart and the joy of our eyes. But before I do that, please a loud salawat ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad. The first thing that we have to do in order to raise children, once again, I mentioned this. Many of you are parents, and others, they're not parents, but one day you will be parents. So please, these advices that I'm giving you, that are all taken from the Quran, they're all taken from the Hadith, keep them, remember them, that once you have a child, apply them. So three things that we can do. The first thing that we can do in order to ensure that we have good, believing, practicing children that give us comfort, don't give us a headache, is what? Number one, develop a good relationship with your children. You see, many children grow up in this country, and his father or mother are strangers to them, especially the father. His father is a stranger. Why? Because he only sees him 1 hour a day. He doesn't know too much about his father, and the father doesn't know too much about his son. Yes, they live under one roof, but that's it. That's the only commonality between them. That's the only common factor. They live under one roof. But the father is busy with his life. The son is busy with his life. And once you have this, once there is no time spent between the father and the son, or the father and the daughter, or the mother and the daughter, what happens is they begin to what? Drift away from each other until there is a barrier between them. There's a barrier between them because the son feels like my father's a stranger. And that's why you find many parents, one thing that they complain about with their children is what? My son or daughter doesn't listen to me. I can't impact him. His friends, they impact him. They have an impact on him. They influence him. But me, I have no influence on my children. They ask why. Do you know why? Because we have no relationship with our children. We know nothing about them. Nothing. His friends, they know a lot about him. That's why he likes his friends. That's why she likes her friends. Because they spend so much time with them. They have so many common features between each other. But the father is busy with his life. The son says, he knows nothing about me. All he cares about is his business. And unfortunately, many parents, the only involvement that they have with their children's life is what? Number one, if the child does something bad, they rebuke them. And they give them orders, do this and do that. And obviously, this creates what? Tension between the child and the father. The child grows up not loving his father. He doesn't know him. The father doesn't really show too much love. He's too busy with his life, with his work, and with his friends. And I'm too busy with my friends. And this is where you see the tension arises. That's why I have to take time to spend it with my child. Every day when we have lunch or dinner together, make sure that your child is sitting there. Speak to him. Speak to her. Ask them, what did you do today, honey? What are you going to do tomorrow? Ask them about their school. Ask them about their friends. Ask them what they like. Get to know your children. To many of us, our children are strangers. We know nothing about them. And likewise, our parents are strangers to many of us. So we have to create that bond, that relationship. Take them out, go to a restaurant, go to Starbucks, and enjoy, and get to know your child. And one of the greatest obstacles, I tell you, my friends, one of the greatest obstacles to this family relationship, and not just family relationships, but all social relationships today is what? What's one of the greatest obstacles to relationships? Technology. This. Technology is smart, my friends, but unfortunately, it's creating dumb people. People that all they know is what? 24 hours a day looking at their iPhones and their smartphones. Our children are growing up, and they don't even know how to talk. Do you know why? They don't know how to speak, because all they do from morning till night to night till morning, they text and they tweet, either on Facebook or Instagram or Twitter or I don't know what, these new ones that I don't even know about. They don't even talk. They don't speak. All they do is what? Texting and tweeting. As soon as the child comes from home, what does he do? He quickly rushes into his room. He jumps and dives into his device, his iPhone, his iPad, his whatever. He puts on the headphones, and for 4 hours, he zooms out. Until the battery dies, he wakes up. Listening to music, surfing, watching YouTube, whatever. You see what kind of an obstacle it's creating? He has absolutely no contact with his mother, with his father, with his brothers, with his sisters. This device, and this is not a problem just for the young ones. I mentioned this a few days ago. Even us, the adults, many times, you see, this is so annoying. You see some people, I mentioned this, when they can't find their phones for 2 minutes, they go crazy. When we go in the bathrooms, we have to take our iPhones with us. When we sleep, so many people, you see, when he's falling asleep, he's like this. He has his iPhone, and then it falls on his face. and it injures his face. How many times you know that's happened to you? And then once we sleep, we put it right under our pillow. We cannot leave these devices for a single second. I remember a couple of months ago, I saw a very funny but sad picture. It was a picture of a family that had gone to visit the grandma. It was the father, the mother, and five children. Three of them, they're a little old, and two of them, they're younger. And the picture, you see, they're supposedly visiting the grandma in her house. So the father, he's on his iPhone. The mother, she's on her iPhone. The three older children, they're on their iPhone. And the two younger ones, they're playing on their iPad. And the grandma's just looking like this. Because she's old. She doesn't have an iPad. She doesn't know what these are. And it was so funny. The comment says, you know, if they would have let her sleep, it would have been better. They're supposedly visiting her. And they're just all on what? On their smart devices, smartphones. So this has become an obstacle. We have to put a limit to this, brothers and sisters. Speak to one another. Doesn't kill to speak to one another. Instead of sending LOL, and most of times, which is not true, you know, sometimes you see some people R-O-F-L. Have you ever seen someone rolling on the floor laughing? Come on. So speak. Well, this is number one. Develop that relationship with your children. Number two, a second important thing when it comes to raising our children is that we have to teach our children about their faith. The hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, sallu ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad. The hadith of our holy prophet says, أَدِّبُوا أَوْلَادَكُمْ عَلَىٰ ثَلَاثِ خِصَالٍ. Teach your children three things. Listen carefully, brothers. This is the hadith of Rasulullah, our prophet. He says, teach your children three things. The first thing he says, أَدِّبُوهُمْ عَلَىٰ حُبِّ نَبِيِّكُمْ. Teach them to love their prophet, our holy prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Teach your children to love him. Teach them about their prophet. Educate them about their prophet. Number two, he says, وَحُبْ أَهْلِ بَيْتِهِ, and the love of his family, Ahlul Bayt, the 12 Imams of Ahlul Bayt. Teach them about, educate them. Educate them about their aqidah, about their belief system. And number three, وَقِرَاءَةُ الْقُرْآنِ. Teach them to read Qur'an. Excuse me. Unfortunately, our young brothers and sisters, our children are growing up. They don't know how to read Qur'an. They don't understand the Qur'an. They absolutely do not connect with the Qur'an. This is our responsibility. And one of the biggest mistakes that we do as parents is what? We teach them sometimes, but we wait too much. We wait too much. We postpone too much. I say, you know what? When my son turns 15 years old, I'll sit and I'll teach him about the Prophet. I'll sit and I'll teach him about Salah. When my daughter is 9 or sometimes 15 or 18, I'll teach them about their faith. You see, in this country, how do we treat kids? The child is a kid until he's 18. And then the next day, all of a sudden, there's a sudden transformation. He's an adult. Until he's 17 years old and 364 days, he's a little baby. There's no responsibility. He doesn't have to do it. But once he turns 18, all of a sudden, he's an adult. So if I want to wait until my son is 15 and I teach him Salah, brothers and sisters, it's difficult, number one. The sudden, swift transformation is difficult. For 15 years, he never prayed. All of a sudden, you want him to pray five times a day? Start earlier, gradually. For 8 years and 9 or 11 months, he never wore hijab. All of a sudden, I want him to wear hijab? Start earlier. Make it a gradual process. It's common sense. This is number one. That's why I should start early. Number two, you find when our children are young, they accept what we tell them. Children, when they're 3, 4, 5 years old, they respect their parents. Anything the father or mother tells them, they accept it because they love their parents and that they know nothing better. They don't have anyone else to turn to. But the more they grow, the farther they get from their parents. Why? Because they start developing their own beliefs, their own ideology. So when I tell he's 15, 17 years old, I tell him pray, he might not necessarily be convinced. Because he has friends that tell him to do otherwise. And that's why we have to take advantage of teaching them when they're young, my friends. Not when they're old. When they're old, it's too late. He's not going to accept. He just wants to rebel. The father and the mother are not cool anymore when I'm 16 and 17. But when I'm young, I accept what my parents tell me. So we have to start young. We have to start early. How early, you ask? When do I start? And this may come as a surprise to you. I tell you, start even before the child is born. I tell you, start even before you get married. I spoke about marriage one night. And I said the factors that we should base our marriages on. If I want to raise a good child, I don't begin when he's 18 years old. I begin even before marriage. When I want to get married, I choose the spouse that will be the good mother for my child. I choose the spouse that will be the good father for my child. Don't just base marriages on love, brothers and sisters. Love fades away. Make sure that that person is what? Is a good role model for my child, that mother and father. So I start even before marriage. And then once I'm married and once the child is conceived, I tell the pregnant mothers, you have a responsibility. Don't wait. While you are pregnant, there's many things you can do. Number one, never eat haram food. Because haram food is what? It's negative energy. And that negative energy goes inside the baby in your stomach. And negative energy translates to what? Translates to negative action. So never eat haram food when you're pregnant. Never eat haram food at all times. But especially when I, as a mother, am pregnant. And number two, the second important thing, is that always make sure that you always have the Quran playing. Always have Quran, you know, cassette player, CD, audio of the Quran. Because science has proven that the child can hear. After certain amount of weeks, the child can hear the surroundings. And I was reading a study that was conducted by the University of Finland. It said, it's so amazing and so interesting. It said that researchers found that babies who their mothers, when they were pregnant, that their mothers used to watch soap operas when they were pregnant. When they were born, these children would be addicted to the melodies of those soap operas. Can you believe that? Because they heard it so much constantly. They would be addicted to those melodies. Imagine if that mother, instead of the soap opera, she would have listened to Quran. The child would have been addicted to Quran. And that's why there's a young boy, many of you have heard of him. He's a Sayyid and his name is Tabatabai. He's from the Tabatabai family. He was 5 years old. He memorized the entire Quran. I've seen his video in Iran. So beautifully, not only has he memorized the Quran, now he's much older. This is many years ago. Not only did he memorize the Quran at the age of five, but he could fully understand the Quran. They asked his mother one day, how did you raise such a beautiful child that he is able to memorize the entire Quran? It's huge. At the age of five, she said, I started the journey very early. Ever since the first day I was pregnant, non-stop Quran. Non-stop Quran is playing all the time when I was pregnant. When the child was born, I used to take a cassette player and place it by his head when he's sleeping and put it on low volume. It's Quran. Obviously, 24 hours when he's surrounded by Quran, he's going to memorize the Quran. It's common sense. So start early, my friends. And there's a story of one of our ulama by the name of Al-Muqaddas Al-Ardabili. This alim is one of our greatest scholars. They asked his mother, what did you do? What are some of the things you did? And one thing that she mentioned is every time I used to breastfeed my child, I used to do wudu before that. Wudu that we do for salah. Every time I used to breastfeed my child, I used to do wudu. So these brothers and sisters don't say, oh, he's a child, he doesn't understand. No, science is telling us the sounds they affect. So I start very early. And once the child is born, if the child is 2 or 3 years old, I have to start telling them about Ahlul Bayt, about Rasulullah. You see, our children, when they're 2, 3, 4, 5 years old, who's their role models? Superheroes. Spider-Man, Batman, Superman, and these new superheroes that exist today. Teach your children that the true superheroes are whom? Are Imam Hussein alayhi salam. The superhero that my little child should always look up to and love is not Spider-Man and Batman. That's fine. But this is all fictional. I tell him what? The true supermodel, the true superhero that you have to look up to is Rasulullah, is Imam Ali alayhi salam, is the 12th Imam, Imam al-Mahdi, ajjalallahu ta'ala farajahu sharif. These are our role models. And once they grow older, they still have role models, but they change. Who's the role models of teenagers? It's the actors, the athletes and the singers who have nothing to give to our youth, nothing. Do they teach them about kindness, generosity, respect of parents, altruism? Nothing. They have nothing to teach our children. Teach your children that your true role model is Ahlul Bayt. The Holy Prophet says, "Allimu, adibu." Teach your children, raise them with the love of Muhammad wa Ali Muhammad. Salli ala Muhammad wa Ali Muhammad. So start the journey at a very early age. Because if I don't and I let my child grow, it's going to be difficult to change him after. This is number two. We said number one, develop a relationship. Number two, teach them about Ahlul Bayt from an early age. And number three, my friends, we have to place limits on our children. We have to constantly monitor our children. Because in this world, there are so many dangers that surround our children, and we have to protect them. And there are three main things that influence, factors that influence our children. Number one, school. They spend 7 to 9 hours a day in schools. And I tell you, my friends, I went to public schools here. If you have the option of not enrolling your children in public schools, instead putting them in private schools, do so. Public schools do not give the best discipline to your children. And here in this community, alhamdulillah, you have more than one Islamic school. I know it may be costly, but wallahi, it's worth the investment. So that's number one. If I can enroll them in Islamic school, do so. Never hesitate. It is worth every single penny. That's number one. Number two is what? The second influential factor for our children is friends. Make sure you know who the friends of your children are. Because even if you give your children the best discipline and you bring them up in the best way, all it requires is one evil friend that drags them back to what? To the evil satanic ways. If you bring up your child in the best way, but he has a bad friend, that bad friend is bad influence. How many stories do I know? A child, a son, a daughter, this young guy or this young girl, they were the best, most bright, you know, students and young people. But because of the influence of one person, peer pressure, it led him to so many evil results. So we have to make sure we know who the friends of our children are. Don't just tell them, go and befriend, and that's it. No, make sure who they are. Scrutinize, monitor. This is number two. And number three is media. We have to put a limit on the media that our children are exposed to. And by media, I mean TV, music. Music should not even be, most of forms of the inappropriate music should not even be in our homes. TV, music, social media, and surfing the internet. Do you know statistics state that an average teenager in the US, how many hours does he and she spend on media? All these four types of media? Up to 7 hours a day. Up to 7 hours a day. Do we know what our children are watching and seeing? Many parents are clueless. Wallahi, I know, because I know the parent, he's lost, and then I go on those, you know, social media sites, I see what those children are doing. Do we know what they're exposed to? Do you think they're gonna teach, social media is gonna teach my child salah? It's gonna teach sawm? Do you think the TV is gonna teach my child to respect me? I don't think so. And that's why we have to make sure that we know what they're exposed to. Monitor, put some limits, scrutinize. There's nothing wrong with that. There's so many dangers in this world. We have to always make sure they're what? They're on the right path. There's so much harm, brothers and sisters, out there. There's so much inappropriate content on the internet. Make sure your children are not getting access to that. And many parents, they would be surprised what their children are doing on social media. They have no clue. They have absolutely no clue what they're doing on social media. I see some children, teenagers. For example, once I went on an account of a girl, and she was a Muslima, and I go on her wall, and all she does is flirt with guys, and she's wearing the hijab. The father has absolutely no clue. That's all she does the whole day. And not only that, but you find she posts so many inappropriate pictures of her. I tell this to the sisters, if I am wearing the hijab, this is a responsibility. Do not post inappropriate pictures where you're wearing the hijab. Keep it private. Send it to your friends or girls. Don't put it in a public post. I see so many times, wallahi, inappropriate pictures that these muhajjabas are putting. It's so disturbing. And the father, the mother, they're clueless. And then I go on the same girl, I go on her about page. Who's her role model? Justin Bieber. And she's a muhajjaba. Does the father know this? Does the mother know this? I'm not saying that take all this away from them. I'm just telling you that place some limits. I remember I read in the news a couple of years ago, there was a mother who, she gave her 13-year-old son an iPhone, but she only gave him the iPhone after putting 18 conditions. Google it. Mother gives her son iPhone with 18 conditions. It was all over the news. She put 18 conditions to the iPhone. Number one, it's mine. You don't own it. You're just borrowing it. Number two, 7:30 p.m., it goes off. until the next day, I don't know what time. Number three, you can't go on such and such inappropriate websites. Number four, up to 18 laws that he had to abide by. This is excellent. There's so many dangers out there, and our children don't know any better. So I have to scrutinize. And a lot of this, I tell you, my friends, even if it's not harmful, it's a waste of time. Our children waste so much time on the social media. You see some people, I see some people that, you know, post pictures and post information and stuff on their, for example, on their Facebook account. They put so much irrelevant stuff. Every day, 10 posts. Now I'm eating pizza. An hour after, now I'm at Walmart. Now I'm taking a shower. Now, I mean, with all due respect, most people don't even care what you're doing. So don't waste your time. What am I going to benefit? Just so I get 10 likes? Just so I get 100 likes? That's how low I go that I'm willing to spend hours just so I get a few likes on Instagram and on Facebook and on Twitter? So it's a waste of time. And most of it, or a lot of it, is harmful. So we have to place, brothers and sisters, we have to place the limits. If I give my child internet, I give him iPhone, iPad, credit card, car, and I leave him and I'm at work, wallahi, I'm not spoiling my child. I'm destroying my child. And let me tell you a story, and we'll end with this. There was a scholar that I heard this story from, a scholar here in the US. He says that one day, a father, he comes to me to the office and he's crying. I told him, why are you crying? He says, you don't know what happened with my family. He says, my son turned 18. And he's a very, very good man, you know, a very religious, faithful man. He says, my son turns 18, so what do? I buy him a car, credit card, the whole nine yards. I give him everything. Now he's what? Now he's supposedly a responsible adult. I give him everything. So he said, alhamdulillah, that's what he claims, I didn't have problems with my son. The next year, my daughter turned 18. So now she comes to me and she tells me, Baba, father, give me what you gave my brother. But he, you know, he's from Middle East. We treat girls sometimes different than boys. So he tells her, my dear daughter, he's a boy. He could have all of that. You're a girl, so I can't give you. So, you know, the youth that are brought up in this country, no difference. So she says she started complaining so much. And what made it worse was my wife. My wife took her side. She started complaining, and she started what? She started nagging and whining. Why is it that you treat your son better than your daughter? Give her. He says, I gave up. I gave in. I gave her everything. He says, a couple of months after, my daughter was being suspicious. She comes back late. She's not there for dinner. She's this and that. So he says, I decided to spy on her. He says, I follow her, and I see that she has what? An unlawful relationship. She has a boyfriend. He says, I was about to die. How can I'm such a holy person. My father is fulan and fulan in the Middle East. And my daughter goes and does this behind my back with the car that I gave her, with the money that I have given her. So he says, I did nothing. He says, I did nothing. When I went home, she came. I told her, daughter, where were you? He says, I wanted to lecture her. I wanted to yell at her. She started yelling at me. Father, how dare you spy on me this and that? And you never asked my brother. He says, a huge quarrel erupted. He said, I was so angered. I took the chair. I threw it at my wife, because he says my wife also took her side again. But I missed. Right away, the wife, she 911. They call cops. And now the children, I have no right to see them. I can't go close to them. And I'm living in hell. Where did it start, brothers and sisters? Where did the problem start? It started from day one. Where there's absolutely no monitoring. There's absolutely no laws. You just give them everything and you think you're spoiling them. Wallahi, you're not spoiling them. This is the exact way that we destroy our kids. So if I want to raise beautiful, faithful, pious children, like the children of Ahlul Bayt, alayhimus salam, I follow these steps and I make sure that I teach them about Ahlul Bayt alayhim salam. I plant all of this faith and wisdom while they are young. Only in that way I can have a child like the son of Imam Hassan, Al-Qasim ibn al-Hassan. Al-Qasim ibn al-Hassan was only 13 or 14 years old. But he was filled with knowledge. He was filled with wisdom. It was the night of Ashura. And I mentioned a few nights ago, Imam Hussein, he brought all his companions. And he told them, look, the enemies want to kill me. Imam Hussein, the grandson of Rasulullah, tells them, The enemies want to kill me. They're not after you. So you guys can go, leave. And then remember I said they turned off the candle. He turned it back on. None of them had moved. Amongst the companions of Imam Hussein and his relatives was Al-Qasim ibn al-Hassan, this young boy. He hears his uncle saying that tomorrow all of you will die if you stay. So if you want, leave. So after the Imam says that, Al-Qasim, he comes to his uncle and he asks him, my dear uncle, أَوَا أُقْتَلُ أَنَا أَيْضًا غَدًا. He says, will I also be killed tomorrow? What does the Imam tell him? What should the Imam tell him? Imagine you had a young 13-year-old nephew that, may God forbid, was afflicted with a fatal and terminal disease, and the doctor said he's going to die tomorrow. And then that child asks you, uncle, am I going to die tomorrow? Can you tell him yes? Can you break his heart and tell him you're going to die tomorrow? So Imam Hussein, he doesn't want to tell him yes, you're going to be killed tomorrow as well, because they had no mercy. They even killed the six-month-old child of Imam Hussein. So Imam Hussein knew even Al-Qasim is going to get killed. But he doesn't tell him that. He wants to test his faith. So what does he ask Al-Qasim? He tells him, Ya Bunay, and he calls him my son. Because Al-Qasim was an orphan. He was the orphan of Imam Hassan. And Imam Hassan, before he died, he had entrusted Imam Hussein to take care of him. So he tells him, Ya Bunay, wa kayfa al-mawtu indak? How do you perceive death? Are you afraid of death? Look at the answer of Al-Qasim. Wallahi, this beautiful answer of Qasim, spend millions of dollars on your children, you can never plant this much wisdom. It's only the love of Ahlul Bayt, the love of Allah, that brings you such beautiful children. You know what Qasim says? He says, Ya am al-mawtu dunaka ahla min al-asal. He says, my uncle, if I die for you tomorrow, it's sweeter than honey. The wisdom of Al-Qasim. Imam Hussein is expecting that he might cry, he might say, why? He says, if I die for you, my uncle, tomorrow, it's sweeter than honey. He's only 13, 14 years old. Imam Hussein, he hugs Al-Qasim. They cry, the day of Ashura comes. All of the companions have been killed. Many of the relatives of Bani Hashim, the relatives of Imam Hussein have been killed. Ali ibn Akbar is killed. Only a few remain. Al-Qasim sees that it is time that he goes to the battlefield, and he makes his uncle proud. And he makes his grandmother Fatima al-Zahra proud. He goes to his uncle Imam Hussein. My dear uncle, give me permission to go and fight these enemies. The Imam, he sees is a young boy and he's an orphan. How can he let him go? He tells him, my dear nephew, I cannot let you go. Forgive me. Your father, Imam Hassan, before he died, he told me to take care of you. How can I send you to the battlefield to die? Forgive me, I cannot do that. So Al-Qasim, he was rejected by Imam Hussein. He goes in a corner. He's so depressed. He's so disturbed. He's so sad. He wants to go and make his uncle proud. He wants to go and fight. So he starts crying. All of a sudden he remembers that when he was very young, there was a will left to him from his father, Imam Hassan. It was a letter. And on that letter, it was written to Al-Qasim from his father, my dear son, if a day of great calamity comes by, if you feel like it's the worst day of your life, open this letter. So Al-Qasim, he remembers that letter. He goes and finds it. He opens it. He sees it's a letter from Imam Hassan to his brother Imam Hussein. He's so happy, he takes it to Imam Hussein. Imam Hussein, as soon as he sees the handwriting of his brother Imam Hassan, he begins to cry. He remembers him. And then he sees in the letter his brother Imam Hassan telling him, my dear brother Hussein, on the day of Ashura, I will not be there to protect you. On the day of Ashura, my son Al-Qasim will be there, even though he is young. Please, my dear brother Hussein, accept my son as a sacrifice for you. Imam Hussein sees now he has no choice. He has to accept this young boy going to fight. So he comes to Al-Qasim. He tells him, I permit you, my son, but there's only one problem. I'm embarrassed of your mother. How can I handle that your mother watches you die in front of her and you're being killed for my sake? I'm embarrassed of her. Al-Qasim tells his uncle, my dear uncle Hussein, ummi inna ummi hiya albasatni la mataharbi. He tells him that it's my mother that is encouraging me. Don't worry about my mother. She's the one that put on my armor. She's telling me, go and sacrifice your life for your uncle Hussein. So don't worry about that. Imam Hussein alayhi salam, he gives him the green light. He goes and he farewells all the women. He farewells his mother, and then he farewells Abu Abdullah al-Hussein, his uncle. Imam Hussein alayhi salam, he gives him the sword, and then he helps him mount the horse, because he's only a child. He's a young child. He cannot mount the horse by himself. He helps him get on the horse, and he goes towards the battlefield. Hamid ibn Muslim, one of the narrators, he said, all of a sudden we saw a young, beautiful boy who was like a shining moon. He came to us while he was reading these poems. And tunkiruni fa ana ya najl al hasan sabta an nabiy al mustafa wal mu'taman hadha husayn kal asir al murtahan wasta unas la suqu sawb al muzal. He takes a sword and he charges against the enemies with great valor and courage, and he says, if you do not know me, then I tell you, I am the son of al hasan I am the grandson of the messenger of God, I am the nephew of Hussein, the one that you have taken captive. He goes towards the enemies. He puts up such a beautiful, courageous fight. He kills some of them. All of a sudden, one of the enemies, he comes from behind him. The sandal of Al-Qasim strips. So it straps. So he goes, he bends down to fix his sandal. All of a sudden, this enemy, he comes from behind him and he strikes Al-Qasim on his head. Al-Qasim falls down. Now you see all the companions, when they used to fall down, they used to say, farewell Hussein, alaykum al-salam. But this Qasim, he was a young boy. What did he say? He said, Amma adrikni, my uncle, rescue me, come to my rescue. Allahu Akbar. Imam Hussein hears Al-Qasim calling for help. He rushes towards the killer of Al-Qasim. Imam Hussein kills him. The narrators say that when the dust settles, we saw Imam Hussein sitting by the body of Al-Qasim. He took the head of Al-Qasim, he placed it in his lap, and then he told Qasim these heartbreaking words. He tells him, Ya azzu ala ammika an tunadi fala yujibuk aw yujibuka fala yughni'ank. He said, it's so difficult for me that I remember you called me, but I was not able to help you. Khasmuhum yawm al-qiyamati jadduka wa abuk. Their enemies will be your grandfather Rasulullah on the day of judgment, and your father Imam Hassan. After that, Al-Qasim's soul departed this world. Aywa Qasima wa Sayyida wa Madluma. Imam Hussein alayhi salam took the body of Al-Qasim back to the tent. Narrators say that the feet of Al-Qasim, they were being dragged against the sands. That means Imam Hussein was not able to stand upright. Imam Hussein did not have enough energy to carry the body of Al-Qasim. He took the body of Al-Qasim and he placed it next to the body of all the other martyrs. He placed it next to the body of Ali ibn al-Akbar. And then all the women, the aunts, and the relatives of Al-Qasim, they came, they saw this little beautiful boy. He's covered with blood and he has been killed. And then the mother of Al-Qasim, Ramla, she comes, she sees this beautiful 13-year-old child of hers. He is covered with blood. She takes from the blood of Al-Qasim and she dyes her hair with it. And she tells him, my dear Qasim, my only wish in life was that I saw you grow up and get married. My only wish in my life was that I saw, was to see you with your children, to see my grandchildren. Inna lillah wa inna ilayhi raji'un. وسيعلم الذين ظلموا آل محمد أيام قلب ينقلبون. Brothers and sisters, please stay seated for another 5 minutes. Inshallah, we shall read a short, brief لطمية ندبية. But first, صلوا على محمد وآل محمد. Everyone repeat after me these words. My son, O Qasim, my son, O Qasim, My son, O Qasim, my son. Everyone, please. My son, O Qasim. My son, O Qasim. My son, O Qasim, my son. Everyone, please. My son, O Qasim. My son, O Qasim, my son. My son, O Qasim. My son, O Qasim. My son, O Qasim, my son. Yumma dhikrini min timur zafat shabab min al-iris mahrum hinti dam al-musab shamat shababi min yitafuha حنتي دمي والجفن ذار التراب يوم ذكريني من تمر زفة شباب. My son, my son, O Qasim. My son, O Qasim, my son. My son, O Qasim. My son, O Qasim. No Qasim, my son. Mother, remember me when you see a newlywed deprived of a wedding. My sacred blood is my dye, candle of my youth. When they turn it off, my blood is my dye, the sand is my only shroud. Mother, remember me when you see a newlywed. My son, O Qasim, my son, O Qasim. Qasim, my son. My son, O Qasim. My son, O Qasim. No Qasim, my son. Yawm al-Mubarak asbah al-Dini shaheed. Wafza' al-Ammi min yidhal bi'l-taf wahid. Ramla b'musabi khalye wasuha. حنتي دمي والجفن ذار التراب. My son, O Qasim, my son, O Qasim. No Qasim, my son. My son, O Qasim. My son, O Qasim. My son, O Qasim, my son. The great day is that which I am martyred for God, and help my uncle when he remains all alone. My mother, Ramla, console her of my death. My blood is my dye, the sand is my only shroud. My son, O Qasim, my son, O Qasim. My son, O Qasim. My son, O Qasim, my son. My son, O Qasim. My son, O Qasim, my son, O Qasim, my son, نسألك اللهم وندعوك باسمك العزيز العظيم العز الأجل الأكرم يا الله 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 اللهم اغفر للمؤمنين والمؤمنات الأحياء منهم والأموات اللهم عجل لوليك الفرج واجعلنا من أنصاره وأعوانه والمستشهدين بين يديه وإلى أرواح المؤمنين والمؤمنات نهدي ثواب الفاتحة مع الصلوات.